All right, we will go ahead and get started. Welcome, everyone. My name is Ryan Ingerson. I'm with the National Renewable Laboratory and National Renewable Energy Laboratory. I'll be your Zoom host for today's webinar. If you have any technical questions, feel free to reach out to me. Please note you will be muted throughout the duration of this webinar. If you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A. You can find that at the bottom control panel. And you can put any questions in there. We will address those questions at the end of the webinar. And please note, we are also recording this as well. So with that, I'll turn things over to Ashrita and Nate, who will get us started.
Good morning. Thank you, Ryan. My name is Nate Blair. I am the principal investigator for the overall storage futures study. Of which you're going to hear a piece of it today. I thought I would just spend a few minutes introducing the overall project before we dive in into the details that Ashrita is going to share. So the overall storage futures study, as this slide indicates, is really working to analyze the increasing role of energy storage in the electric grid through 2050. So there are a variety of factors at play, from increased levels of low-cost solar and wind on the grid to the need for distributed storage, and combining that with, as you can see, both existing and anticipated reductions in cost for lithium-ion batteries in particular. So we've looked at a number of different things, both at the grid level, looking at the phases of deployment, cost and performance of a variety of storage technologies, not just batteries, and both grid scale adoption, and what you're going to hear about today is distributed scale storage adoption and some of the factors that influence that. And all of this work can be seen on our website, which is at the bottom. And our key conclusion, as you can see on the right from these grid scale scenarios, is that under all scenarios, really dramatic growth in energy storage is the least cost option. So these are least cost scenarios. We look forward to talking about distributed storage today, but feel free to go to the website and take a look at some of the other products that we have. Next slide. And as I said, we have released the first four items on this list. So the four phases of storage deployment, model input data report, which looks at broadly at storage technologies, the diurnal storage scenarios, and the distributed storage adoption scenarios, which you're going to hear about today. We have two more reports coming, grid operational impacts of storage, and then a key learning summary, both of which should be out sometime this fall. And with that, I will turn it over to Ashrita to dive into the work that she led.
Thank you, Nate. So first, I'd just like to say that I'd like to introduce my co-authors, Kevin McCabe and Ben Segrin, who also authored the report alongside Nate Blair. So today I'll be talking about the Distributed Solar and Storage Outlook Report. So I'll start by explaining some of the methodology behind deriving adoption projections and then go over some of our main results. So the Outlook report analyzes adoption of behind the meter storage co-adopted with rooftop solar. And to examine the drivers impacting storage deployment, we ran several scenarios through 2050 using DGEN, an open source tool developed at NREL. So before conducting the analysis, we first implemented the capability to analyze storage adoption in DGEN. And another important aspect in this analysis was to examine the impact of the value of backup power on storage adoption. So by simulating multiple scenarios and comparing the projections from these different scenarios, we try to identify some trends and drivers of behind the meter solar and storage adoption. So before going into the methodology, I'll I'd first like to give a brief overview of DGEN, the Distributed Generation Market Demand Model. So DGEN incorporates detailed spatial data, and the figure on the left shows some examples of the multiple layers of information which are used in each DGEN simulation. So here we have, for example, resource potential, electricity consumption, site suitability, and we also use a number of other socioeconomic aspects for each parcel or each customer. Simulated customers within DGEN make decisions to purchase a particular technology based on its cost effectiveness. And since we run scenarios through 2050, our focus is more on identifying trends and drivers rather than producing precise for near-term forecasts. So the method which is used to project adoption in DGEN involves several steps within each simulation run. So the first step is to identify technical potential. And an input to this is often LiDAR data, which is used to identify rooftop availability for solar. In this study, for the case of storage, we don't have any physical constraints. However, we do limit the storage system size to be a fraction of the PV system size installed at each customer site. Next, we identify the economic potential, which is the total capacity that has a positive return on investment. So for each simulated customer, we start first with calculating the net present value for the maximum system size. Then we step through different system sizes while optimizing for the highest net present value. And through this optimization, we are able to identify the most cost-effective system for each particular customer. And then the sum of all of these, the capacity of all of these systems is the economic potential. The third step is then to identify the market potential or the maximum addressable market. And this is based on willingness to pay surveys. So for example, based on the surveys, we have a relation between the payback period of systems and the percentage of customers who are likely to adopt given a particular payback period. And this is also a way of representing the hurdle rate. So finally, in the last step, by using the maximum market share as the upper limit of adoption, we apply the Bass diffusion model to represent the diffusion of technology over time. So as you can see, in each step of the simulation, we obtain intermediate results, which are then used in the next step. So examining how customers' desire for backup power could impact adoption was a very important part of this analysis. And we assume that this desire for backup power can be represented by customer willingness to pay to avoid service disruptions. So two main data sets were used to calculate a regional and sector-specific value of backup power. The first was EIA 861 data on the average frequency and duration of outages by utility across the United States. The second was customer willingness to pay data from the value of service reliability report by LBNL, by Sullivan et al. So this is the same data used in the interruption cost estimate or calculator tool or the ICE tool. And the figures below show this value, average value of backup power by state for the different sectors. There are similar trends across the sectors. For example, states on the East Coast of the United States tend to have a higher value of backup power. And this is because they do have, they have a reported higher frequency and duration of outages. And then another point to note is that in the industrial sector, the value of backup power tends to be several thousand times that in the residential sector. And again, this is because the metric for willingness to pay is higher for the industrial and commercial sectors. The modeling of battery storage systems in DGEN is through using the system advisor model, which is also developed at NREL. So we use the PV watts model, the battery model, the cash loan financial model, and the utility rate or the technical modeling of utility rates from SAM. And these are integrated into the DGEN framework through a Python wrapper to SAM. So both the net present value and the payback period, which are important metrics in DGEN to calculate the economic potential and the market potential, are outputs of SAM. Since this was the first time we evaluated storage adoption using DGEN, because we also implemented it before doing this analysis, the focus of this outlook is based on current tariffs, current incentives, and expected R&D improvements. But the scenarios modeled in our analysis were set up to look at sensitivities for three main aspects: the technology cost, the value of backup power, and distributed energy compensation mechanisms, or DER valuation. So for technology costs, the sensitivities we look at are reference costs, which is just mid-cost projections for both PV and battery. And then we look at low battery costs and low PV cost projections. Then for the value of backup power, the reference value is that average value of backup power by state and sector presented in the previous slide. Then we also consider a scenario with no, without any value for backup power, and then a scenario with a value of, with a high value of backup power, which is simply double the value of backup power across all states and sectors. And for a DER valuation, we consider the reference, net metering, and net billing. So in net, the reference scenario considers DER compensation for different states as is the current policy. So it could be different states have policies which could be net metering, net billing, or buy all, sell all. In net metering, customers receive full retail credit for the energy that they produce but do not consume, that is the excess energy. In net billing, this excess generation is valued at a predetermined sell rate, while in buy all, sell all generation is valued at a predetermined sell rate. So the sensitivities that we consider here are in net metering, all states move to net metering from 2020 onwards, while in net billing, all states move to net billing compensation from 2020 onwards. So here's the full list of scenarios, which are combinations of the sensitivities presented in the earlier slide. And we run 10 scenarios in total. Now I'll talk about the results. This figure presents an overview of the results from the base case scenario in 2050, and it's just to give an idea of how that technical potential, which could be quite significant, then gets filtered down to adoption projections. So here in the base case, in 2050, we have about 1,163 gigawatts of PV and 116 gigawatts of battery capacity as a technical potential, which eventually ends up in 152 gigawatts of PV and 8 gigawatts of battery capacity, which are projected to be adopted. So now looking at the economic potential and the projected adoption, the figures on the right, on the top shows the full range of economic potential, and at the bottom, the full range of adoption projections. for all scenarios through 2050. So we see that there is significant economic potential under all scenarios, ranging from 85 gigawatts to 245 gigawatts, or 170 gigawatt hours to 490 gigawatt hours. However, the projected adoption of behind-the-meter battery storage is only a